We tell ourselves America won the space race in 1969. But here's what nobody talks about. The Soviets beat us at almost everything else. First satellite, first human in space, first woman in orbit. We just decided the moon was the finish line. But what if there was never a finish line? What if the race just paused, and now it's back with players we never saw coming? On October 4th, 1957, the Soviet Union catapulted the world into a new era when they launched Sputnik, the Earth's first artificial satellite, into orbit. This event struck a nerve deep within the American psyche, challenging the United States' position as a technological superpower. The response was immediate and palpable, igniting an existential crisis among the American public and its leaders. Newspapers like the New York Times framed the achievement as a major Soviet triumph, and the reaction from the US government was swift. Senator Lyndon B. Johnson expressed his alarm, stating, "Control of space means control of the world. The Soviet Union has made a significant advance in our plans for the conquest of space." In response to this perceived threat, the United States accelerated its efforts in space technology, leading to the creation of the National Aeronautics and Space Administration, NASA, just a year later on July 29, 1958. While President Eisenhower publicly struck a measured tone after Sputnik, the US quietly sped up work behind the scenes. This formation was not just about exploring the final frontier, but also about securing military and strategic advantages over the Soviet Union. This urgency was echoed by administration officials in public and private, who emphasized the necessity of catching up to and surpassing Soviet space achievements. NASA's creation placed a civilian agency at the forefront, even as deep military concerns helped drive the US space agenda. The American public's fear that the Soviets could now potentially launch nuclear weapons from space further fueled the frantic pace of US efforts. Educational programs in science and technology received unprecedented boosts in funding as the government encouraged a generation of young Americans to become scientists and engineers. Testimonies from that era, such as that from a New York school teacher, reflected this shift. Every student wanted to be a part of the space race. Science fairs were no longer just about volcano models. They were about rockets and satellites. The launch of Sputnik had indeed reshaped American priorities and perceptions. As part of these reactive measures, the US government initiated programs like the Advanced Research Projects Agency, ARPA, in February 1958. Which later played a pivotal role in the development of modern technologies, including the internet. The sentiment of national urgency was palpable, with Defense Secretary Neil H. McElroy frequently framing the challenge in stark strategic terms. As the US scrambled to regain its footing in this high-stakes competition, President John F. Kennedy's declaration in 1961 to land a man on the moon and return him safely to Earth was not merely about exploration. It was a bold strategic maneuver intended to leapfrog an adversary that appeared to be outpacing the United States on several fronts. This dramatic shift in American space policy marked a pivotal moment where the space race encapsulated not only the struggle for technological supremacy, but also the broader Cold War confrontation. President John F. Kennedy's speech on May 25, 1961, which declared America's intent to send a man to the moon and return him safely to Earth by the end of the decade, was more than a bold vision of space exploration. It was a Cold War strategy cloaked in the guise of scientific ambition. Kennedy's advisors, including Vice President Lyndon B. Johnson and defense analyst Robert McNamara, were clear about the geopolitical stakes. McNamara later recounted that the Soviet Union's earlier successes with Sputnik and Yuri Gagarin had created a palpable fear that the USSR would dominate space and, by extension, global geopolitics. The Apollo missions were thus conceived as a countermeasure to demonstrate American superiority, not as quests for knowledge. Indeed, the public rhetoric surrounding the Apollo missions often celebrated the scientific breakthroughs and the promise of space exploration. However, internal communications and meetings from the era tell a different story. Memos from the National Security Council and CIA during the early 1960s underscored the importance of beating the Soviets to the moon, suggesting that American policymakers viewed space primarily as a strategic asset. The space race was fundamentally about showcasing technological and organizational prowess to the world, and the moon landings were the crowning public relations and psychological warfare tool. When Neil Armstrong and Buzz Aldrin planted the American flag on the lunar surface on July 20, 1969, it was a clear signal of American technological and ideological triumph. The decline in lunar missions post-Apollo 11 further illustrates the geopolitical motivation behind the space race. Once the Soviet lunar program faltered and ultimately failed to achieve a manned moon landing, American interest in the moon waned dramatically. Apollo missions were curtailed, and budgets for lunar exploration were slashed. Apollo 17 in 1972 marked the last manned moon landing. This rapid pullback reflected not a fulfillment of the scientific quest, but rather a diminishment of the moon's value as a Cold War battleground. For 30 years following the end of Apollo, the narrative around space exploration shifted towards international cooperation and scientific inquiry, as seen with projects like the International Space Station, launched in 1998 with the collaboration of 15 nations, including former rivals, the United States and Russia. However, this era of relative detente in space was disrupted by the rise of new global players in space technology, notably China. The launch of China's Chang'e program, which successfully deployed a rover on the far side of the moon in 2019, the U-22 rover, rekindled nationalistic motivations for space exploration, reminiscent of the Cold War era. The US response, the Artemis program, aimed to return Americans to the moon, rooted in a 2017 policy shift and later organized under the Artemis banner. With timelines that have since moved to a first crewed flight in 2026 and a crewed lunar landing no earlier than 2027, suddenly taking on an urgency not seen since the 1960s. This resurgence of competition demonstrates that the underlying drivers of the space race have remained largely constant: geopolitical rivalry and the demonstration of technological and economic might. While the narrative of exploration and discovery is appealing and publicly palatable, the enduring investments in space by the world's powers reveal their true intentions. As we stand on the brink of a new era in lunar and possibly Martian exploration, it is crucial to recognize the lessons of the past. Space has always been, and perhaps always will be, an arena for earthly competition and power projection. In the intricate ballet of international relations and space exploration, the US's decision not to include China in the International Space Station partnership, followed by U.S. legal restrictions on NASA-China bilateral cooperation in 2011, has proven to be a pivotal moment. This exclusion was not merely a diplomatic snub, but a catalyst for China to forge its own path in the cosmos. Faced with isolation, China launched an ambitious space agenda that has, over the decades, transformed it into a space powerhouse rivaling the United States. By 2003, China had launched its first astronaut, Yang Liwei, into orbit aboard Shenzhou 5, marking its status as only the third country to independently send humans to space. This mission was emblematic of China's resolve and technological prowess. Fast forward to 2011, when China laid down another milestone with the launch of Tiangong 1, its first space station module, thereby laying the groundwork for a permanent presence in orbit. This was a clear demonstration of China's commitment to fulfilling its promises in space exploration, a stark contrast to the collaborative but restrictive environment of the ISS, from which it had been excluded. The exclusion also seemed to have invigorated China's lunar ambitions. In 2013, the Chang'e 3 mission successfully deployed the U-2 rover on the moon, making China only the third country to achieve a soft lunar landing. This success was followed by an even more ambitious mission, Chang'e 4, which in 2019 became the first spacecraft to land on the far side of the moon, deploying the U-2-2 rover, a feat not yet attempted by any other nation. These missions underscored China's growing competence and confidence in space technology. On Mars, too, China has made impressive strides. In 2021, the Tianwen-1 mission successfully inserted the Zhurong rover into Martian orbit, followed by a successful landing, marking China as one of the elite spacefaring nations to both orbit and land on Mars. Each of these achievements was not just a technological triumph, but also a clear signal of China's unwavering resolve to be a leader in space, independent of international partnerships that had earlier shunned it. The U.S. observing China's rapid advancements has had to reassess its own space strategies. The realization that a new formidable competitor had not only emerged, but was thriving in areas where the U.S. had hoped to lead, reignited a sense of urgency. This competitive spark, reminiscent of the mid-20th century space race, has catalyzed renewed American investments and interest in lunar exploration and beyond. Programs like Artemis, aiming to return humans to the moon, with a first crewed lunar landing now targeted no earlier than 2027, show America's reinvigorated commitment to not just participate, but lead in the new era of space exploration. Thus, what began as a strategic maneuver to limit China's space capabilities inadvertently nurtured a space rival. This development serves as a profound reminder of the unintended consequences of geopolitical decisions. Suddenly, America remembered why we went to space in the first place and scrambled to respond. In the grand scope of history, such twists are poignant. They reflect our continuing struggle, not just with the physics of rocketry, but with the complex dynamics of global leadership and rivalry. In this renewed space race, every launch, every mission, and every discovery is not just a step into the unknown, but a measured step in an enduring high-stakes geopolitical dance. In 2017, under the Trump administration, the United States issued a policy redirection toward a return to the moon, later organized as the Artemis program, directly aiming to sustain U.S. leadership amid China's rapidly advancing space capabilities. The Artemis Accords, pivotal to this initiative, set out principles for the peaceful use of space and have been adopted by a growing coalition, including countries like Japan, the United Kingdom, and Australia. Supporters see them as a way to operationalize cooperation under existing space law, while critics argue they align signatories into competing blocs, predominantly arrayed against efforts led by China and Russia. China, in response, has not stood idle. Their ambitious lunar exploration plans and the 2019 landing of the Chang'e 4 mission on the far side of the moon, deploying the U-2-2 rover, underscore their intent to be a leading space power. Russia, too, has reasserted its space ambitions, rejuvenating its Soviet-era legacy of space exploration. This tripartite division echoes the geopolitical tensions reminiscent of the Cold War, but with a distinctly modern twist involving a competitive and strategic race for lunar and Martian territories. The militarization aspect of the new space race is particularly concerning. The United States Space Force, established in December 2019, represents the first new armed service branch in over 70 years, underscoring the military stakes at play. Alongside, China's strides in anti-satellite weaponry, showcased by their 2007 missile test, have sparked concerns about the potential for space to become a new battlefield. This development raises critical questions about the control of strategic space-based assets and the vulnerability of global satellite systems, which are integral to national security and civilian infrastructure. The Artemis Accords, while aimed at fostering cooperation in space exploration, also implicitly lay the groundwork for an alliance that could exclude non-signatory powers from new frontiers. This has led to criticisms from various quarters, including Russia, which has likened the Accords to a lunar NATO. Such divisions highlight the emerging legal and territorial disputes as nations stake claims to extraterrestrial resources, particularly in strategic locations like the Moon's South Pole. As this new chapter of the space race unfolds, the echoes of historical rivalries mix with modern geopolitical strategies, presenting a complex landscape that could potentially escalate into a more dangerous confrontation than witnessed during the Cold War space race. The question remains, not whether we are in a new space race, but whether this race, with its heightened military overtones and alliance-based rivalries, poses a greater threat to international peace and security than its predecessor. The first space race gave us one giant leap for mankind. The second might determine whether mankind takes that leap together, or tears itself apart trying to claim the stars. If you enjoyed this story, hit subscribe for more fascinating historical deep dives every week. Thanks for watching.